This is the brain of a mouse, and this tiny red dot is a piece of microplastic. It took just 3 weeks of drinking water contaminated with plastic for a piece to enter the bloodstream, cross the blood-brain barrier, and embed itself deeply, and trigger dementia-like symptoms in this mouse. So is this happening to you? The bad news is that we've all been ingesting microplastics our entire lives, and our intake is increasing exponentially. At what point will we reach the threshold for a toxic dose, or are we already there? Watching this video will change the way you think about everything you buy and consume, but it might also just save your life. So we've had the Stone Age, Iron Age, Bronze Age. Where are we now? Some people are calling it the Plastic Age, or Plasticine, which is pretty embarrassing as well as alarming. The vast majority of this plastic is made from fossil fuels like crude oil, natural gas, and even coal. And since production took off in the 50s, we've generated around 8.3 billion metric tons of it. So much that it's made its way into the Antarctic ice cores and has become a part of Earth's fossil record. So we've had to classify a new marine habitat as the plastosphere. Even our raindrops contain plastic waste. So fear about all this plastic isn't new. I mean, we've all been shuddering at clips of water bottles on Everest and, you know, plastic bags on beaches and the drinking straw up the turtle's nose for years, right? So what we didn't know is that it's not the big stuff that we should really be worried about. It's the tiny stuff. It's plastic that's less than 5 millimeters long. And plastic we can't even see that's the real danger. It's called microplastic and nanoplastic. And it's a planetary and health crisis that's invading our everyday lives. So the problem with these particles being so small is that we can ingest them without knowing it. They're in our food, our water, they're in the air, we're breathing. Like right now, I'm breathing in freaking plastic. Fish and livestock are eating them, and even our crops are absorbing microplastics through their roots. There is nowhere you can go and nothing you can do without taking at least a small amount of microplastic into your body. So imagine sitting down to enjoy this bowl of mussels. For every 10 grams of food, you're taking in 3 to 5 visible fibers of microplastic. But most of you won't be surprised about that. After all, plastic has been in our oceans and making headlines for years. And we know that fish have been eating floating microplastics for food. Filter feeders are full of it. And the birds that feast on seafood have been found dead from starvation with their stomachs full of plastic. However, what might shock you is that during the meal, you'll actually inhale more plastic than you'll eat. Then, if you wash it down with like 500 mils of bottled water, you'll consume another 120,000 tiny pieces of nanoplastic. Now, if that doesn't sound good to you, make sure you stick around to hear the surprising ways you can cut hundreds of grams of plastic from your diet. And while I've got your attention, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. It really helps us bring you more content like this, and we really appreciate it. So when we first found out that we were ingesting so much plastic, the hope was that we'd excrete it naturally. I mean, after all, plastic is pretty inert. It's not like we can break it down and digest it, right? Well, unfortunately, new studies have revealed that it's not that simple, and it's turning up in some pretty terrifying places in your body. For example, researchers in Italy recently analyzed the plaque from arteries of 304 people with carotid artery disease. Shockingly, they found microplastics in the plaque of 60% of the patients and concluded that those with plastic were 4.5 times more likely to have a heart attack, stroke, or die in the 34 months following their surgery than those without. The idea is that these microplastics act as a form of scaffolding, which increases the rate of plaque growth and therefore the risk of cardiovascular issues. But it's not just our hearts that are under threat. To get a better understanding of just how dangerous these particles are, let's take a look at what happens after you ingest them. The first stop microplastics will make in your body is your stomach. Some of your good digestive microbes will feed on and cling to the microplastics. They can change the chemical composition and alter your gut microbiome for the worst. Your numbers of good microbes will plummet, and antibiotic-resistant microbes and disease-causing pathogens will take their place. So after disrupting your microbiome, the smallest particles can pass through the mucosal barrier and embed in your gut walls. This can trigger an immune response and the release of inflammatory proteins called cytokines. These proteins are linked to inflammatory bowel diseases like Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. These are conditions that have been mysteriously skyrocketing, with cases almost doubling between 1990 and 2017. So, even more concerning is that the plastics are never just plastic. We add all sorts of chemicals to improve performance, like plasticizers and lubricants and dyes and flame retardants. Many of these are toxic, but companies have been allowed to add them to products anyway because people were never meant to eat them. So of course, we are eating them. And these chemicals can cause cancer, hormone disruption, DNA mutations, developmental disorders, infertility, and a lot more. And these are all entering our bodies in this Trojan horse particle called plastic. Some of the most worrying studies have found that mice exposed to microplastics had significant testicular inflammation and severely damaged sperm. So this is raising the question, could microplastics be one of the reasons global sperm counts have halved in the last 50 years? Then there's BPAs and phthalates. These are chemicals used to make microplastics, and they're known to be endocrine disruptors. What the heck are endocrine disruptors? Well, endocrine disruptors are natural or synthetic chemicals that can disrupt the body's natural hormones, which can then cause cardiovascular disease, obesity, reproductive disorders, and several hormone-related cancers. Their usage has even been banned in things like baby bottles and food contact plastics. However, new research has revealed that we've not gone far enough. While most food packaging is BPA and phthalate free, our water, soil, factory tubing, conveyor belts, and gloves used in the production of all this stuff are still full of it. One American consumer report found that 99% of supermarket foods still contain phthalates and 79% contain BPAs. But even if the BPA-free claims were true, it doesn't mean that the plastic product is safe. It just means it doesn't contain one of the many chemicals that could affect your health. In addition to the stuff we intentionally add, plastic particles can attract and carry heavy metals like cadmium, chromium, and lead into our bodies. At toxic levels, these can cause all kinds of problems like kidney dysfunction, nervous system disorders, vascular damage, and cancer. But of course, your stomach isn't the only entry point where microplastics can get into your body. You know, when you fluff a cushion or shake out a blanket and a cloud of dust floats out, that's not just dead skin cells and hair, which you might think already is bad enough. It's actually thousands of tiny plastic fibers from man-made fabrics like polyester. So once all the stuff is airborne, it's impossible to avoid breathing the fibers into your lungs, and if you're lucky, they'll be coated in mucus and expelled by coughing. Some might even embed themselves and leach out of toxic chemicals that cause scarring, fibrosis, inflammation, and cancer. Lab studies using human tissue grown to resemble lungs found that microplastics reduced the number and size of airways forming by 67 and 50%. And that's terrifying when you consider plastics have been found in placentas, breast milk, and newborn stool. Plus, milk heated in plastic water bottles is causing babies to ingest more than 660,000 microparticles a year. Unfortunately, plastic's journey through your body doesn't just end at your lungs and your intestines. The smallest pieces can cross cell walls and enter your bloodstream. And this isn't rare. 80% of us have plastic coursing through our veins right now. Once in your veins, the plastic is on a superhighway around your body and can infiltrate any organ, even your brain. And this is terrifying because, as I mentioned earlier, in rodent studies, microplastics in the brain have been linked to dementia, Alzheimer's, and depression. Okay, so do we need to panic? Unfortunately, we simply just don't know. So far, all causation studies have been done on animals or isolated human cells, not on living people. Scientists are giving us their best guesses, with some calling microplastics first generation cigarettes. They're harming us, but just slowly enough that they can fly under the radar for a while at least. They're also concerned that the results of the animal studies aren't giving us the true and possibly much more horrifying picture. You see, when they dose microplastics in a lab, they use specially produced spherical beads. But in reality, we're ingesting strands from fabrics and irregular plastic flakes that have broken down through wear and tear. Unsurprisingly, jagged and needle-like fragments can rip through cells and cause much more cell death than smooth beads. Plus, real-world plastic contains a soup of toxic chemicals and has often picked up heavy metals. So it's all possible that the studies done so far have vastly underestimated the threat we're facing. So having microplastics in our body is most likely a bad thing. But where is it all coming from? Firstly, the most obvious source is these large beads of plastic, like bottles and bags. When we first noticed our plastic pollution problem, the main concern was that they take thousands of years to decompose. But it turns out that the problem is they're actually breaking down too fast. From the second they're manufactured, plastic products start to shed tiny nanoparticles of material that we eat, drink, and inhale. Then once discarded, they're physically and chemically decomposing, releasing thousands of microplastics into the environment. Microbeads are another source that we picked up on a few years ago. These are tiny plastic balls that are famous for being added to products like skin cleansers and toothpaste. Thanks to huge campaigns, they're now banned in cosmetics. However, their use in agriculture, paint manufacture, and industrial detergents is flying silently under the radar. Another huge problem is fabric, particularly polyester, in clothing, carpets, rugs, and upholstery. Every time you wash a garment, you release around 1900 microplastic particles into the water, which are then small enough to travel through sewage treatment plants and make it into rivers and oceans. Where we use sewage sludge on our crops, the plastic enters the plants through the roots and gets stored for us to eat later. A European study found that they were dousing their farmland in 710 trillion microplastics every single year. Of course, fabrics constantly shed fibers without being washed, which causes 33% of our indoor airborne plastic. But going outside for some fresh air isn't much better. As tires break down, they shed a huge amount of plastic that forms clouds of dust and gets washed into rivers. Even the ocean spray is filled with microplastics that are getting launched back into the air. We've found particles in the deepest ocean trenches, the most remote mountains, and trapped in Antarctica's sea ice. There's literally no escape from it. An even bigger concern is that with every passing year, more plastic is entering the environment and none of it has broken down yet. Every generation is going to face an ever-increasing load of microplastics. So while our bodies are mostly handling it for now, we don't know what it'll be like for our kids and theirs. By now, you're probably wondering how to limit your microplastic load and detox it from your body. The best thing you can do is avoid exposing yourself to additional plastic with easy wins. So, for example, instead of drinking out of a plastic water bottle that's gonna hit you with nearly 1,000 microparticles and 240,000 nanoparticles per liter, switch to metal. I personally like Yeti, which is made from insulated stainless steel. And no, this was not sponsored by Yeti. This is my actual water bottle and I love it. Of course, as plastic is everywhere, your tap water will contain microplastics too. Although nowhere near as much as a plastic water bottle. A great way to avoid this is by installing a reverse osmosis water filter in your home. These can capture microplastics as small as 1 micron in size, as well as viruses, bacteria, and heavy metals. If you've seen canned water from brands like Liquid Death and are wondering if it's a convenient way to avoid drinking plastic, well, I got some bad news for you. Aluminum cans are lined with ultra-thin layers of plastic to stop the contents reacting with the metal. By dissolving the can from the outside, we can actually reveal the hidden plastic sacks we've all been unknowingly drinking out of. If you're grabbing a quick drink from the store, glass bottles are the safest choice. To drink safely while traveling, carry a steel bottle. If you really need to use plastic, use a product made of thick, sturdy, and unrecycled plastic. I tend to go after Fiji, personally, because it's a thicker bottle. It is recycled to some extent, so not super excited about it, but when you need some water, like you have to choose, the Fiji bottles are usually the ones I go with. So when you're traveling through airports, take your stainless steel bottle and you empty it out before you go through security. And on the other side, most of the, at least the bigger airports, they've got water fountains and filtered and water that stations that you can refill your stainless steel bottles in. Do not ever, please do not ever refill a plastic bottle. And the reason for this is the plastic is already saturated, the water that was already in the bottle with microplastics. And then what happens is you refill it and all the plastic that couldn't be saturated back into the water fills up into the new water. It actually can be worse for you in many cases. Also, always ensure that it says BPA-free and phthalate-free. Even though we know this isn't always a guarantee, accidental BPA contamination is still better than intentionally added. Another thing to consider is that plastic containers shed far more microplastics when they're heated. So if you're microwaving food, always do it in glass or ceramic. Do not use plastic. Plastic doesn't have to reach boiling point temperatures to leach into your food and drinks. Just being in a hot car is enough to trigger the process. This is why you should never leave your water bottle out in the sun or trust single-use bottles that might have been heated in transit. Another easy thing to avoid are cutting boards made of plastic. Some studies have shown that we ingest a staggering 50 grams of microplastics a year by preparing our food on them. In fact, the only place plastic should be in the kitchen is the freezer, because when frozen, it sheds far less. So I have no problem eating plastic packaged frozen food. Always remove the plastic and heat it in glass or ceramic. It's also a good idea to consider products that use innovative plant-based plastics like Seatopia. They use packaging made of corn and sugarcane that is recyclable or compostable and doesn't contain any toxic chemicals. Another thing to think about is your clothes and furnishings. If you can, choose natural fibers like cotton or wool, and it's also a good idea to use a microplastic catcher or install a microplastic filter on your washing machine. If you're worried about the plastic that's already lodged in your body, unfortunately, there's no magic way to find and pluck it out. However, studies are starting to show that your diet could help. Lactic acid bacteria found in fermented foods like live yogurt, kimchi, sauerkraut, they can all bind to and degrade BPA and phthalates into harmless compounds. On a wider scale, we as humans need to reduce and clean up the amount of plastic we release into the environment. And fortunately, we're working on it. Wastewater filtering, incineration, and ocean cleanup are all underway and accelerating as we now are seeing the scale of the problem. There have also been several recent breakthroughs in biodegradation. This means using enzymes or microbes to break down plastic and turn it into biomass or carbon dioxide. One example was discovered partly by accident by a biotech engineer researching several different fungi. A sample ballooned out of the jar, and when she cut it open, she discovered the mushroom had eaten the plastic sponge that was supposed to hold it in. Another team has lab engineered a strain of E. coli to transform a molecule from PET plastic into the edible flavoring vanillin. Finally, multiple teams are collecting bacteria found in landfills and compost heaps and using them, or lab engineered versions of the enzymes they produce, to either break down or recycle plastic. However, scientists are warning that we need to be careful of something called techno-optimism. This means we shouldn't rely on developing some miracle technology to save us from the plastic epidemic. The reality is we need to produce less, use less, and try to work towards circular rather than single-use consumption. So now that you're up to date on the science behind microplastics, are you planning on making any changes to reduce your intake? Let me know in the comments, especially if you've got any tips of your own. If you've enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. This will enable us to bring you more content just like this. But while you wait, why not check out our other video, which explains the hidden dangers of seed oils that you must know about.